Okay. I'll be talking about Groovy. Who about you knows Groovy already? Okay, nobody. Ah, okay, few guys. And I won't be using a microphone, so if I'm not loud enough, please raise your hand in the back. The final thing is, it's a lot of material. I'll be starting with the simple things in Groovy, and then we'll have some final examples, for instance, a web server in 25 lines, which I'll be showing you working, which I find quite cool. And this is the general thing for me. I'm absolutely fascinated by Groovy because Groovy provides you with everything that Java has. It's fully compatible with Java. And at the same time, it's much easier to use. So as a general assumption, when you program Groovy and you think something should just work, then it will. And it's a fascinating feeling when you're really programming and you think, okay, I don't know the method name, but let's try this. And it works. So you get quite used to this. And when then you get back to Java, you start to get frustrated very soon, very fast. So if your main language in the future is Java and you have no chance to work with Groovy, again, this other talk is quite fascinating. Okay, we will have a short look at the language itself, see use cases, see the handling of Groovy regarding everything in its universe, because one of the big problems in Java is that you have primitive data types, meaning that you have numbers that are not objects. Numbers are something for which the normal rules regarding objects, which you have in an object-oriented world, and which you should have in Java as well, don't apply. So there's quite a number of frustrating things. And Groovy, from the beginning, decided, okay, we simply drop the primitive data types and start with objects. After all, the single reason why we have primitive data types in Java is performance, which in my personal opinion is one of the stupidest motivations to change an approach you have in a language. Who of you programs Java since, say, 1996, 97? Okay. Few guys. If you look at Java 1.0, 1.02, or even the Alpha 3 that came out before that, you will see that in the design of the classes is presented the fact that the guys who designed Java had no knowledge about object-oriented language design. They learned it on the fly, which is not the worst thing to do, but still, in the design of Groovy, many of the problems that have been introduced to Java have simply been eradicated. Okay, we will see how we can work with collections. We have one new type of collection in Groovy. See control structures, which are more or less the same. But an important thing, if you're talking control structures, loops or whatever, then in normal languages, you use loops to iterate through something. It got better with the introduction of iterators in Java, but nonetheless, normally you have some kind of looping through values in a list, a map, or whatever. And this is the wrong abstraction level, and Groovy is all about abstraction levels and tries to introduce a differentiation between what you want to do with the objects in your collection or whatever and the way you iterate through them. In normal Java, this is mixed. Okay, then operator overloading. You know from Java that there is no operator overloading. Groovy introduces this. There's under the hood quite a few of tricks which I don't have the time to talk about in detail, but if you want to look up, for instance, call site caching and so on, this is quite an interesting thing to look at. And the newest versions of the virtual machine have instructions that allow dynamic languages like Ruby or JRuby, Jython, and so on, to be extremely fast, comparable to normal Java, with maybe a factor of, say, 1.5 or something, and still keep the whole dynamic aspect on a normal virtual machine. Incredible. Okay. Closures, which are, in my opinion, really fun to play with. You know anonymous classes? Okay, yes. Yay, fantastic. Okay, I know you just had your lunch and you're tired. Anonymous classes are a first step in the direction of closures. Closures are anonymous functions or lambda expressions. You have different names for that, depending on where you are from. If you're a mathematics guy, it's more lambda expressions. If you are a functional programming guy, it's first order functions, higher order functions, and so on. But closures are similar to anonymous classes without all the baggage, without this, or the code that you do not really need to express what you want, but simply need to help the compiler understand. And this is, again, the important thing in Groovy. We have removed everything that is not expressing the extent of the programmer. So what stays is what you want to say, what you want to do to solve your problems. Okay, categories, you can change. I mean, a dynamic language offers you a lot of functionality to change the methods, attributes, whatever you have in your objects at runtime. And categories are one way to do this, to change, for instance, a method of an object for a time being. Maybe later it has its original functionality back. So you can modify on the fly for some short period of time in your code and then get back to the original way to do things. And then I show you some examples, one of them being a web browser, I think, in 30 lines, another a web server in 25 lines, I think, and a few other things. And you will see that the code that I have there is not arcane, or you don't understand it. On the contrary, it's quite easy to understand what happens. So this means you have really 25 lines for something that is not complicated. I mean, if you are thinking about the simple functionality of a web server, you access a resource with a URL, a symbolic name that somehow references, in the normal case, references something in your file system, and this is returned to the browser. So what's complicated there? And you will see exactly that. Okay, this here is a picture from Alice in Wonderland. It's an original drawing from the first printing, but yeah. Okay, Groovy is a scripting language on one hand and is a regular programming language on the other hand. It runs on the virtual machine. And is derived from Java. This means that, in fact, every Java program is a syntactically correct Groovy program. This was not absolutely correct in the beginning because there was one exception, but in the meantime, I think since 2010 or something, every Java program is a correct Groovy program. So if somebody wants to change his ways from working with Java to working with Groovy, it can be a slow process. You don't have to learn totally new ways to express yourself. For instance, if you learn Scala, a language that I personally like very much, then you have to learn a whole different way to express what you want to program. If you know Java beforehand, it gets problematic because all the time you are bugged with your normal Java knowledge that hinders you to write syntactically correct Scala code. With Groovy, it's different. You switch, and you, after a few moments, you don't even remember that you switched because you work on and on in quite a normal way. Groovy is a dynamic language, meaning that with every method call and an operator like plus or minus is nothing but a method call, the method called might be inspected and the parameters or the call itself might be changed. So everything is dynamic in Groovy. You know the dot between an object and the call of a method? This as well is an operator. So everything is possible. It's absolutely incredible. If you understand Groovy in detail, if you understand the functionality that works this magic under the hood, you can do nearly everything with the language. This doesn't mean that you should do everything with the language, only that you can do whatever you want. And this in the next step means that you can implement a lot of internal DSLs, domain-specific languages, we will see an example for that later, in Groovy without any problems, providing you, or for instance, someone from the business side of a company to express their problems in a concise way in their own language, translating that automatically to normal Groovy or Java in turn. Okay, what else do we have? It's officially specified in 1JSR 241, doesn't matter that much. And one interesting thing, Groovy is quite old. Groovy is older than 10 years. I mean, if you compare that to Java, then it's only half as old, but nonetheless, Groovy has been implemented in its first version in 2003. And I personally work on Groovy since, I think, 2005 or something like that. Not 2006. It is in the top 20 list of TIOB. That is a list of the most interesting or most used programming languages. And many of the other hype languages right now, for instance, Clojure, I think, is on place 87. Scala is somewhere in the 60s and so on. And for a language that old to get into this top 20 list is quite impressive in my eyes. Current version is 2.18. And there's constant further development. That's it. First example, Java. Okay, I assume that all of you know Java. Anyone who doesn't know Java? .NET World? Anyone? Okay. So this is nearly the shortest program that you can program in Java, right? I thought about it, you can maybe shorten the string here, but apart from that, it gets quite problematic to get a shorter program. Okay. And if you look at it, we have this here, this line, that line. They are boilerplate. They don't really provide any functionality to your solution of the problem, meaning printing out, in that case, hello world. So they shouldn't be needed. And then system out, I mean, yeah, or the semicolon. The semicolon is something that helps the compiler, nothing else. So it should be optional. And if we see the groovy equivalent, and this is the exact, not exact because I have an additional space here. This is the equivalent which under the hood will be turned into exactly this by the compiler and then transferred into bytecode. So this is what you wanted to say, and in Java, this is what you have to say. So this is one of the main differences between Groovy and Java. Groovy doesn't use boilerplate. It simply provides you with all the functionality you need to express the solutions to your problems. By the way, the shortest Groovy program is this. And this is a valid Groovy program. Okay. You believe me? Okay, fantastic. And it doesn't get much shorter than that. I mean, you can discuss the complexity of the problem that we attack here, but nonetheless, if we are talking boilerplate, then there's absolutely no boilerplate here. Okay, use cases. You can program scripts instead of using shell scripts, instead of using Perl. Anyone still using Perl? Nobody? Okay. Perl seems to be a dying language. At one time in your career, look into this programming language. If you think you know a perverse way of programming, Perl will teach you better. There are things in Perl you don't even want to learn. So, might be interesting. Unit tests. Groovy provides you with a lot of mechanisms to very easily program your whole test framework, making you much more productive. I mean, tests are necessary, but it is not really fun to program them normally. With Groovy, it's fun again, and you even do something good because these tests are used to verify the rest of your system. So that is a very good way to use Groovy. Then, and you have direct support for stubs, for mocks, for lots of tricks that you don't have in normal programming languages. Then full-blown applications. Anybody has played with Grails? Okay. Dushan, very good. Grails is a web application framework where with a minimum overhead, you create a full-blown application. Only a few lines of code are necessary to have a CRUD web application, create, read, update, delete, and nearly everything is created by the underlying framework or is provided on the fly through convention over configuration ideas in this framework. Parts of it has been stolen from Rails. Anybody used Rails before? Okay, Dujon, fantastic. But it's grown very much beyond it. So Grails is a very interesting technology. If you simply want to rapid prototype a website, fully blown website, or if you want to create a smaller website for yourself. Then Griffin is a framework that provides the same functionality that Grails provides, but for Swing clients. And it's a very interesting framework, and it's much fun to play around with that. And then integration in large applications, and this is one area where Groovy really shines as well as glue code, simply to bind different parts of an application together in varying and changing ways. One customer of ours, for instance, uses Groovy scripts. They are stored in a database, fetched from the database, and then executed to calculate on the fly the values of different funds, financial instruments, and so on. Then, for instance, class by class substitution for Java. Everybody here knows Spring, I assume. Okay, who doesn't know Spring? Okay, only a minority. Brilliant framework, you should look into it. And in Spring, Groovy is a first-class citizen like Java. So class by class, you can use either Groovy or Java and switch between these two languages at least as you need it. Because I said Groovy is slightly slower than Java. So in some cases or some areas where you really need the last bit of speed, you will stay or still stay with Java. Then as a configuration language, for instance, for Gradle, which is in turn a substitute for Maven, or as a domain-specific language, because in Groovy you can create domain-specific languages quite easily. Okay. I think most of that I've told already. It's similar to Java, it's more or less the same, it's easy to learn. The Java object model is used, but the primitive data types are thrown away, which even if you have this here, this program really creates an object. So it's not a primitive data type, it creates an object, sets the value to one, and then returns as a result of this program one to the caller, the operating system. Groovy tries to follow the principle of least surprise. I said that already. If you think that something should work, it will work. And there's a lot of energy went into providing this experience. All Java classes can be used, seamless interfacing with them, and the translated Groovy classes are normal bytecode, which means you can call Java from Groovy, you can call Groovy from Java, interact however you want between these two languages. Typing can be strong or weak. If you are using the scripting functionality, you most often will use weak typing. In other cases, you might use strong typing. You can force the compiler to do that or to guarantee that you have strong typing, and you can switch between dynamic or static compilation, which means that you can in fact turn off the dynamic part of the language at all in your code if you want to. You won't, but it's there. I told you that everything is an object. We don't have the primitive data types. In fact, we have the primitive data types, but we don't use them. Only if we call a Java method that needs a primitive data type, then Groovy switches back to primitive data types itself. And this, that everything is an object, allows us code like this here, where we have a number and a method called on this number, because Groovy sees this as an object, as a normal object, as anything else. Wouldn't be possible in Java. And this simply means this number of times call whatever is between those curly braces. We come to that later again, but this here is a closure. So that is quite nice, I think. Typing is optional, or explicit typing is optional, especially in scripts. You can simply start typing. And if you do that, like in this simple example, then Groovy under the hood uses your source code, places the whole source code into a run method in a class that it generates on the fly, and then calls this run method. you have the keyword dev with which you can create a reference to something that is not specified any further. You can could write here number or a decimal or whatever, and that would work as well. But dev simply says, okay, I have a variable and I won't specify the type. Please, dear compiler, find out for yourself. Under the hood, what happens is that this will be changed to a reference to object, but the runtime system will guarantee or will examine every object during any call to verify that whatever you call on an object works on it. Okay, then we have collections. You know collections from Java, lists, maps, whole bunch of different variants. And Groovy adds a new collection type, range, which is an interval of objects between a minimum and a maximum. If you're talking about numbers, I will give you an example. Then, for instance, a range between 1 and 5 will mean every number between 1 and 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You can even create those ranges upon your own objects with a few tricks, and works fantastic. For the existing types, lists and maps, there's a lot of syntactic sugar that allows you to use them much more easily than in Java. And finally, these interfaces are harmonized, meaning that if you have one method for one of those collection types, then you will have it for every other collection type as well. This goes into the direction of the least surprise. So every, for instance, every object in Groovy has a method size. So if you want to find out how many elements a list has, you call the size method. If you want to find out how many characters a string has, you call the size method, and so on. So there's not that much to remember. It simply works. Okay, here we have examples. Defining an inclusive range uses two dots between minimum and maximum. An exclusive range, two dots and the smaller sign. This leaves out the last element. And so you can create everything you want quite simply. And then you have a normal collection. For instance, you can iterate through it, do everything you can do with any other collection. And the most impressive thing here is the elements between minimum and maximum are created when needed. Meaning, if you have a very large collection, or a very large, very large range, then the objects between minimum and maximum are only created when you need them, for as long as you need them. So if you have a range, for instance, from 1 to 100 million, you won't need the memory for that. When you iterate through the whole range, the objects are created on the fly and then thrown away afterwards. Okay, the simple trick you can that allows you to create ranges for objects that you create yourself is you need a comparable interface with its method and a method next and previous that provide the next element in a range or the previous element in a range. And this is everything you have to do. This allows the range class to iterate through your own objects as you like with the next and the previous method. Okay, lists. You know the normal way to create lists. Groovy provides syntactic sugar in form of the square brackets that allows you to create a list much shorter than you would in Java, to add members to your list, to remove lists, to calculate difference between two lists, the union between two lists, and so on and so on. And you can, with the method each, iterate over the list without problems. Groovy provides us with a number of different iterator methods, and each is one of the interesting ones. It simply goes through every element and does something with every element, the closure that you provide. In principle, you could say, okay, this could be done in parallel as well, but for that, Groovy provides a method of its own that's called each parallel, that allows the Groovy compiler to parallelize the calls. Okay, subscript operator, the brackets operator is also allowed. Then maps are written with string and or key and value. The key in every normal case is a string. And so this is quite comparable to the notation you use for creating normal lists. And you can also iterate through each of your entries. And in that case, you get a structure or an object that contains a key and a value. So you can check for every value and every key. The shortened access is the one, at least I use the most, because with map dot and then the key directly after the dot, I access the respective value. And this makes programming quite nice.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
15 minutes left.
Okay, I haven't even started. Okay, thank you. Then control structures. With all these iterator methods you have, of which each is only one example, you don't need the normal control structures as often as you would think. Many programs need them rarely at all. So most of the time you use one of the other iterator functionalities. But when you need it, everything that normal Java has, while loops, for loops, and so on, is provided. And in addition, this notation for name in list type or collection type, do something, is provided as well. And this notation was even provided before Java 5 offered this for something colon in or in list notation that is that came with Java 5, and I never understood why they didn't simply take this notation, because in my eyes it's much nicer. Okay, the most important difference in the area of control structures is Groovy truth. If you have a normal control structure in Java, you have to provide an expression that evaluates in some kind to a Boolean false or true. You don't need that in Groovy, because Groovy coerces collections, iterators, enumerations, every type of object to a Boolean false or to a Boolean true. For instance, if you have an empty string, then it's Boolean false. If you have a null pointer, then it's a Boolean false. If you have an empty collection, then you have a Boolean false. So you can quite simply iterate over a, not that you need it, but over a list by while, and then as an expression, name of the list. And if you then remove inside your control structure elements from this list, the whole thing will stop as soon as you no longer have any elements that you have to process. And this leads to a changed switch statement in which you can use every possible expression and in which the value you provide here is evaluated against this expression, a closure, for instance, or a range or a type. Everything is possible here as well. I mean, Java just changed their switch statement from totally crappy to still crappy, but we could discuss it, with the introduction of strings in the case statements. But it still is a real problem compared to something like this. We simply write what you want. And this comes from every one of those expressions being evaluated and then using Groovy Truth being coerced into a Boolean true or false. Okay, then operator overloading simply works. For instance, the operator plus. If you want to overload the operator plus, then you simply provide in your class a method plus. With minus, it's the same. With every operator, it works in the same way. And your own implementations of that are pretty straightforward. Here I define a class complex that contains a real part, an imaginary part, and a method plus that simply takes an object of the same type and returns a new object that is the sum of the two complex values. And when I use this, I create here a complex object and another complex object and use the operator plus, then this plus automatically maps to this method, which in my eyes is incredible. I would show it to you, but then we don't have time for the rest. Then closures, brilliant stuff. You can do nearly everything with closures. You can create generator functions. You can put filters after these generator functions. For instance, with a number of closures, you can create a prime generator that simply puts out one prime after the other. Quite simply written down, but to talk you through that would need too long. But closures are everywhere in Groovy. Every time you see a curly brace opening, or nearly every time you see a curly brace opening in any one of these examples, it's a closure. And here you have one. Or here, this. If you have a general definition, define a closure, starting with curly braces, then parameters for the closures, default parameters and the source code, and then the end of the closure. And this is a first order function. You can use the reference, you can call upon the reference, simply executing this functionality. A few examples. Here I create a closure called square that does nothing else but square the argument given. I can, for instance, iterate. I can use square later in the definition of another closure. And I can even define closures that take other closures as arguments. And then it starts to get interesting. Okay, yeah, blah, blah, blah. That's the definition of what currying means. You can, and this is another interesting functionality, you can define a closure with a number of arguments and then reduce the number of arguments by providing values. And thus, lowering the, that is called arity, the number of arguments, and fixing some of the values that are provided. Here I define a closure that multiplies the values that I provide, x and y, x times y, and then I simply curry this with the value 2. What is generated now is a closure that takes this value 2 and places it here, so that now you get something like this closure. I can use the same closure here later and generate a new closure that is curried with number 5. So all of a sudden, I have a from a multiply closure, I generated a multiply by 5, a multiply by 10 closure. And this works with simply everything. And here I define a closure that concatenates two other closures. And if I use these two and multiply five closures as arguments here, then I get another new closure that multiplies by 10. So I can build everything I need from basic building blocks, simple building blocks. Yeah, there's another way to do this. Okay, yeah. I will need 15 minutes, 20 minutes. But I know Dušan is the next speaker, so. Now, Groovy adds a number of functionalities to everyday objects, even to Java objects. And you can do this yourself simply by using something called category. If anyone has programmed in Objective-C, then it's the same concept. You define a method in your category for a class, and this provides this method to an object of this class while this category is active. And you turn it active with the keyword use and then the category, which means that a string, test string, in this case, fixed by this string reference here, will have for this time the method hello. This works. If in the next line I try the same, I get a method not found exception, an error, because outside of this area where the category is active, the method no longer exists, which makes it quite fascinating, simply for a small time window to provide a functionality that is not needed or would even be harmful in some way or another outside of this small time window. In former times, for instance, Objective-C programmers on next stations, where Objective-C was first used, used this to get around registration checks. But I never did such thing. Okay, now some examples. Oops. XML parsing. This is a normal XML. Nothing special here, unreadable like every XML. I have a root, Groovy, then music, tunes, title, artist, and so on. This is a program starting here and ending here that reads in the whole XML, parses it, creates an object tree from it, which I can navigate however I want, and then prints out for each tune the title and the artist. So this is XML parsing in Groovy. Now imagine you wanted to do the same thing in Java. This is no longer fun. And this here is the actual result. So that's Groovy in practice. Now, a web server in 25 lines. You see, the path to the directory is provided on the command line. Then I define a pattern that allows me to isolate the name of the resource that is wanted from the URL or from the whole command that the web browser sends to my web server. And then I open a server socket on 5926, and while true, accept any connections, pass through it. Here I match this pattern. When I match, or if I match it, I extract the resource from the matcher and try to access the resource. And here return the information together with the necessary meta information. This is a web server. And since you won't believe me, I simply cut it from here, paste it here, start it. Okay. This wasn't the effect I wanted. Oh, wait. Forgot something. I get it from the current directory. Oops. Okay, now it runs. Okay, it simply runs. This is the Groovy console where you can play around with Groovy. Now I open a new window. This is my mail. And local host 5926. Anybody an idea what this 5926 means? Okay, pardon? Okay, yes, but yeah. Yeah, what the number means. Okay, now I have a test HTML. This is test HTML, and I can test HTML.html. Ta-ta. Works. And if I do something wrong, then okay, this should have worked better. Okay, it should have worked like that. But yeah, not everything works perfectly well. Nonetheless, you've seen that the web server functions without bigger problems, at least. So this here is a fully functioning web server in 25 lines. And this is something I find quite nice. And it's not, I think, unreadable, right? Okay, next thing, web browser. Doesn't have that many lines. I think it's around 18. And, I don't have enough time. It works as well. What most of the program does is creating, using a swing builder, these panels that show the result and above it the URL, and allow you to type in a new URL or click onto a URL and then change the view to the new website. Then domain-specific languages. Up there, this is a domain-specific language. Music sheets. A domain-specific languages provides a vocabulary for a specified problem domain that allows you to concisely express what you want to express. And music is a pretty good example for that. Normally, it's not used by domain by IT personnel, but by domain experts. This allows you to talk to the business guys as well. And you have two approaches. An internal DSL that works inside your normal programming environment, or an external DSL. Here are examples for internal DSLs. For instance, 2.kilometers plus 5 millimeters plus 3 yards plus 2 miles is a result. How many lines do you think this needs? Okay, it's less than 200, so I think 195. It starts with a unit class that encapsulates these distances, or the units, the kilometers, millimeters, and so on. Then a distance class that uses these units. And then a category that adds to normal numbers the unit classes. And this is all. This, and this is all that you need to, in the next step, use this category and do something like this. And it even provides the functionality to compute the distances in different metrics, to change from yards to kilometers, for instance. Okay, and all that we have seen so far is provided as functionality by the Meta Object Protocol that in Groovy examines every call and decides what to do with it. A Meta Object Protocol is nothing new. It comes from the 80s, where it was invented for Smalltalk. But Smalltalk was only the first language that used it. It's been used all over the programming language world, and Groovy uses it from beginning to finish. And one example for the Meta Object Protocol, yeah, it's only Dusan who is next. yeah. Is this method? I'm nearly through. You have a class that provides a method called invoke method. This leads the runtime environment to decide that if a method is not implemented inside the class, then this method will be called. So if an object here, for instance, doesn't have this method, hello world, then the call is routed to this invoke method. And the result is this, which in turn means you can, for instance, create something that looks up tables in your database based on the names you call it with. And then it gets strange. Okay. The final question, Groovy, is it worth it? Yes, it is, in my opinion. Lots of explanations, but finally, yeah, it is. We haven't looked into much of Groovy. There's lots more there, but at least we have seen something. If you want to have more information, you can look at the website, groovycodehouse.org, or get yourself Groovy in Action, a quite nice book, The Standard Works for Groovy. And this is it.